So, I believe you, the project has already been introduced, and of course with the two PhDs and the 12 countries. One of the things we are doing also with the Global Tax Governance is to try to raise awareness in developing countries what they are doing and how these new minimum standards will link or will bind them, if they bind their own, but in my view they bind it. And then what are the differences, what are the problems that we can have, and of course the principal purpose test is one of the problematic issues. So for instance, when I was last year in September at the OECD in the BEPS Inclusive Framework, so the BEPS Inclusive Framework, where normally all countries get together, and I was invited as academic expert, the first thing they say, welcome academic expert, we are not going to talk about the principal purpose test. And the meeting was about tax certainty. So for me it was kind of like, okay, we cannot talk about it. So actually we didn't, because it was tax treaties and they didn't want to discuss it. So that brings a little the topic of how it's being dealt with right now. And one of the things that we also think about it, and this is the discussion we have with panels, whether this could be customary international law. And if so, how this will link to the interpretation as well. Because I thought not only looking at customary international law, but looking at your project interpretation of customary international law and taking it one step further. And that's why I thought to discuss today. So, sorry for knowing the tax lawyers, I think you have got a crash course in what means international taxation. How can I get this one?
Yeah, I don't think that one doesn't work very well.
Okay, then I'll get this one. So, principal purpose test, and I was mentioned customary international law and the interpretation. We have already 128 countries, and from the 193 countries in the world, and it's important, as you think they have been mentioned before, the multilateral instrument. It is important to distinguish because the inclusive framework, in principle, is self-law. So the 128 countries have these four minimum standards. There is no document that they signed, but they have committed to implement the BEPS four minimum standards. The multilateral instrument is a convention, an international treaty that has been signed, has been ratified, has been sometimes reviewed by the Constitutional Court or whatever review they have to have, and then deposited in the OECD. At this moment, we have 87 countries who have signed it, but the process of deposit of the signature and after the ratification of the parliament is still taking place. And for instance, for the Netherlands, it took place last week. But in addition to that, we do have the BEPS 4 minimum standard of principal purpose test that is now being codified in the OECD model and the OECD commentary. And the OECD model, OECD commentary, has a new in Article 29, that is called entitlement to treaty benefits. And that means then that this OECD model, in principle, is being followed only by OECD countries. However, when an OECD country wants to sign a tax treaty with a non-OECD country, they also use it. And the question is, and it's in 2017, so also issues of interpretation in respect of dynamic static interpretation and the Vienna Convention of the Law of the Treaties. So this, in all three of them, so you see, inclusive frameworks, soft law, MLI, convention, OECD model, also soft law, but kind of guidelines, in all three, there is this topic of principal purpose test. And that's important to think about. When the principal purpose test started, so you have the BEPS project, and then you have the actions, 15 actions, and you have BEPS action 6, when they discuss about the principal purpose test. And the question, there were two elements that they wanted to have. First of all is the general anti-avoidance rule, as I will explain in a second, and second of all, also a preamble. And this preamble is also important, because once you start interpreting this general anti-avoidance rule, you will have to test against the object and purpose of the convention. And this object and purpose of the convention will be, in this case, also the preamble you have adopted. So the principal purpose test look like this. A preamble and a treaty provision that will take one of the three forms. Either way, you have a principal purpose test, or you have a principal purpose test with simplified of detailed limitation benefits, or you have a detailed LOB with anti-abuse measures to counter financing. In this case, for instance, most of the countries are introducing the principal purpose test. Some countries, very few, are also saying we have simplified or detailed limitation of benefits. I'm only focused on the principal purpose test because the limitation of benefits is kind of a checklist. But the principal purpose test as a principle gives a lot of interpretation. And detailed LOB, very interesting enough, this is the US. Because the US say, actually, we are part of the BEPS project, but we are not gonna sign the MLI. So we are not part of this convention, but we were the ones who started. And this is the way that the US got to negotiate, in my opinion, the way that they say, we will do it in our way. So this is exception US. This report just was published, the first report on the BEPS implementation of the principal purpose test, has been published in 14th of February, so last week. So, I mentioned to you the preamble. The preamble says, normally when you talk about tax treaties, you talk about tax avoidance and double taxation. To prevent double taxation, to tackle tax avoidance. Now, with this preamble, we also have non-double taxation, double non-taxation. One of the forms that they have is also to have treaty chopping, for instance, including treaty chopping arrangements. And then in addition to that, you also have an additional party can introduce the desire to further develop their economic relationship and to enhance their cooperation in tax matters. So when a tax administration is going to interpret the principal purpose test, we need to have it taken into account, not only double taxation or double non-taxation, can result in treaty chopping. And for some countries, you may think about this economic relationship. The minimum standard is the Article 6 as it is the preamble, so the first part, the additional test. This Article 6.3 is a choice. And the countries who have signed the multilateral instrument have introduced that choice, have introduced that. Not all of them, but for instance, Cyprus, Malta, Curaçao have introduced this. This brings to the situation where even if you may say this does not result in double non-taxation, still, like in the case of India, very good example, it is still okay because we need to develop economic cooperation and we need to have an economic relationship. I don't know which country was gonna argue that first, but I know India is always, like, I don't know, there was a kind, I don't know if this was the case with Mauritius.
Yeah, it was.
There you go. So, because normally treaty chopping takes place in India through Mauritius, but then, of course, it's Mauritius in this case. You didn't want to say that Mauritius was helping with treaty chopping. This is a very political thing, in my view. So we have this interpretation. But let's look at the principal purpose test as such. There are three elements. First of all, there is a benefit. So you need to have a treaty benefit. The treaty benefit means Article 6 to 22 and means all this type of income, real estate income, income of labor, business income, and so forth. In addition to that, you have this subjective and this objective element. And here is where it comes a little, the differences, because it used to be before that normally the tax administration will say you have treaty shopping, and I will prove it to you, taxpayer. So the tax administration will have the burden of proof. Nowadays, it switched. So the tax administration only has to reasonably conclude, in according to the facts and circumstances, that obtaining the benefit was one of the main purposes. And you, taxpayer, you need to prove otherwise. And you need to prove that that benefit was in accordance with the object and purpose of the relevant provisions of the covered tax agreements. That means we need to go back to the preamble. Remember when we're talking about double taxation, double non-taxation, and also the economic relationships. So this burden of proof is what the principal purpose test has done right now. There is a reason for that. So, well, the reason for that is actually that perhaps because this, in my view, because this multilateral instrument that countries found this nice opportunity to kind of put a position on the principal purpose test, they perhaps decided in this case we are going to change the burden of proof. Of course, you need to agree that all countries will tell you it is the reason, but I wasn't there during the discussions and it will not come out of the consultations. What is interesting is if we are changing this burden of proof at tax administration level, because there are two tax administrations, two countries, there is a tax treaty, in this case a treaty shopping, what is going to happen with the court? Because once you go to court, you will need to prove also. And in this case, for instance, if there is a benefit of doubt, the doubt should go to the, on the benefit of the taxpayer. This is one Vikram Chand who has written about this. We do not have yet cases that when the principal purpose test has gone into court. I don't know how they will do it. I don't know if in case of India we need to have this principal purpose test, we'll have the same case as it was for Mauritius. I don't know. But this is something that we need to think about. So once we look at the principal purpose test, we need to look at customary international law, and I will not stay too long here because they have already been said a lot. But what is important is that customary international law, international tax is not new, and you have already seen that. And nowadays we also have in the International Law Association, there is a study group on international tax law, where it's been discussed that the sources of international law and the categorization of human rights applicable to taxation matters and how this fits in all this law. So this is not only an old topic, but it's also a new topic with a new switch or thing, a new thing that will have this. The study group of international tax law, that next year, it was in Kyoto, no? Next year. Or is this year?
2023.
Okay, good. So this year, no. Next year in Kyoto, it will be discussed as well. So, the question is principal purpose test international customary law? The law that results from a general and consistent practice of states, followed by them from a sense of obligation. Then you may need to wonder whether what is the principle? There was an antecedent to the principal purpose test. And in this case, we can find it in the guiding principle of the 2003 OECD commentary, but it was not used by OECD countries, and also not by non-OECD countries. And this guiding principle also say, a guiding principle, the benefits should not be available when a main purpose for entering into certain transactions of arrangement was to secure a most favorable tax position, and will be contrary to for the object and purpose of the relevant provisions. That was something before, in 2003. It was not used, but now, of course, have the principal purpose test, so we now have 128 countries, so I could say it's widely used, the principal purpose test. So with principal purpose test, you have a, could lead to international customary law, and I'm very, very careful here because I'm not that expert, even I said it to Pan, saying, check whether I'm not saying wrong things about it. But one of the things we have is that, and we need to make a distinction between the countries who have made part of the BEPS inclusive framework or the countries who have signed the MLI. Because if you have the BEPS inclusive framework, you may say, it's soft law, in principle I'm not. I will have a peer review by the OECD Secretariat and the peer review group. So I may be forced in a way to comply with that. But if you are from the MLI, you already choose that, have chosen that. So you say, in my treaties, I will do it. However, it's also important when you analyze the treaties and the multilateral instrument, to which treaties? Because normally when you have the multilateral instrument, the countries will say, I apply to these treaties, what we call the covered tax agreements. So for instance, if you have 60 treaties, you will apply to 50. Very few countries decided to apply to all of them. One of them actually was the Netherlands, except for a few, three, four, five treaties, but the rest was applied to almost all treaties. So the question comes also again, you have this principal purpose test, in principle it's in a multilateral instrument, you say, Cyprus, I will use it for my treaty with the US. But if the US is not part of the multilateral instrument, how does it work? So I would have, in that case, you have this kind of mismatches what we also working a lot with the multilateral instrument. And of course, almost all countries try to get the US to agree to a principal purpose test. But again, the US had a specific rule in the principal purpose test that, that I mentioned to you before. So this is problematic. The other point that you have is that if there is no MLI, it's not binding, but there is an expectation that countries will adopt. You have sources of interpretation, you have BEPS Action 6, the terms of reference, and the peer review reports, the one just published last week. If there is an MLI, it's a binding instrument, but I mentioned to you, Article 6.3, economic relationships from the preamble is a choice. So you have reservations, options, only applicable to the tax treaties, the covered tax agreement, because it needs to be a match. So if you say, I apply to the US has also to say yes. Otherwise, it will not apply the MLI. But you have also sources of interpretation, explanatory statement of the multilateral instrument. But the explanatory statement of the multilateral instrument refers to the 2014 OECD model. So it does not refer to the 2017 OECD model where we have now this Article 29 entitlement to treaty benefits. Can you follow me here? So, if we have the 2017 OECD model and commentary, it has 87 pages, only the commentary. And I was saying like 2-3 weeks ago, I was saying to a lot of tax advisors in Cyprus, I said, well, I have time because I'm academic, but even that takes a lot of time to read all of that. And the point is that even if you have this commentary and you have this Article 29 to try to clarify what the principal purpose test is, because it only says how the principal purpose test interacts with the limitation of benefits, but also some elements of the principal purpose test. The role of the what is the role of Article 3.2 of the OECD model and the Vienna Convention of the Law of the Treaties? Because if you are gonna apply interpretation, how you are gonna do that? First of all, of course, good faith. Then you have this context, you have this teleological mechanisms on there. And how do you apply that? I do not have the answers yet, actually. But if someone knows, more or less, try to help. So, and the question is, you have here your tax treaties that are covered, your tax treaties that are not covered, you have the MLI, you have the Article 29 of the OECD model 2017, how you are going to interpret that? What is the context? That's the first important question. And also whether there is good faith. And other problems that we have that I learned when I was doing here my PhD with Irene is about the dynamic and static interpretation. Because if you have the principal purpose test and you have been part of the BEPS inclusive framework before 2017, or you signed the BEPS MLI before 2017, will you apply then only the OECD model of 2014? That would be a static. Or will you apply the 2017? The static dynamic interpretation. So it brings other problems because if you're listening, you see France is very legalistic and they will be against dynamic interpretation. So even if you have an Article 29 OECD model, say it's entitlement to treaty benefits, 87 pages for a commentary, you don't know if you can use it. Yeah?
Could you come to a conclusion?
Yes, I do. So this is the conclusion. So question is, some issues for further research. We are talking about the object and purpose. And I mentioned to you about the preamble, I mentioned to you about economic relationship, economic taxation. But do we really need to have to the whole picture of the treaty or not? Also, what is the role of the explanatory memoranda and commentaries in the interpretation? How we are going to do that? Because at the end of the day, the principal purpose test is tested against the purpose and the convention. And also the problems with the reference to the 2017 and OECD model. Thank you.